Hi, my name's Juliet, and today I'm going to be talking about the APA paper format, following on from last week's video, in Scrivener 3 for Windows. So, what do we have in the template? Well, the About section gives you some notes on how this template works. Some of these instructions will be the same across multiple templates. Something I didn't notice when I did last week's video is that most of these also have an example paper in the research folder. This one has two, a student paper and a professional paper. Some of these example papers are, like the student and professional papers here, literally a paper with dummy text. Others give more detail on what you're seeing. In the binder, there are a series of folders with specific purposes designated by their titles, although these can obviously be changed. Most of these are blank, simply set up in the right structure to display correctly when compiled. However, there are two that aren't blank, not including the front matter. References has a list of example references, with a disclaimer about following the APA or your institution's guidelines. However, it is in double spacing with a hanging indent. You don't have to worry about the text in the red box. That's a comment and won't appear in the final document. The footnotes page is set up with code that will place your footnotes here in the document on compile. The formatting here will, therefore, only become apparent when compiled. However, if you don't have any footnotes, this may be unlikely, remember to move this page to the trash or remove it from the list in compile, or it will appear generated with the code. When it comes to the two title page formats in the front matter, anything in curly brackets has to be overtyped, and project title and full name will be taken from the compile metadata, which you need to fill out. If you don't need any of the items, just delete them. Back to the main text. These document levels refer to different levels within the guidelines. I'm going to mark this as we go through, but I'm not going to say what they're supposed to look like, because things like that are the most likely things to change in updated formats. Always check that these are correct in your final document, just in case. If they're not, you'll have to change the section layouts in compile. The first sub-document level within main content is Level 1 APA sections. The second sub-document level is Level 2 APA. The third subdocument level is Level 3 APA, and so on, up to APA Level 5. We only have Levels 1 and 2 here, so I'm going to add some others in so you can see the generated result. And I'm going to put some dummy text into these documents and add a few footnotes. Be back in a moment. If you need any block quotes or other indented passages, you are instructed to use the block quotes style from the styles list. Or you can create specific formatting and, well, Scrivener suggests you use the preserved formatting tool. I tried this and it didn't work for me. It only preserved the italics and not the indentation. I tried creating a new style instead, basing it off the block quote. This worked on some of the formatting, but not all, specifically the line spacing. Why? Because I found out there is one further step for this to work. The style has to be added to the format. Who'd have thunk it? So, in compile, right-click on the format you want to use and duplicate it, name it, etc. If you don't know about creating new formats in compile, I have other videos on that. Go into the item named Style in the left-hand column. This lists the styles in this compile format. Over on the right, you'll see a plus. Click on the arrow beside it and it lists all the styles. Simply select your new style, then click on it, and in the formatting box below, select the line spacing as double-spaced, because this is where that's defined, and you'll have a working, customised style. Phew, that was a pain. But it's done now. Well, in this manuscript. If you're going to use this a lot, you might want to choose the My formats instead of project formats option. Another thing that the template mentions is using figures and tables and numbering them. I'm going to do a separate video on that because it's a topic that people may want to find out about separately. So make sure to check out my next video. Okay, now let's go back one step to the standard formats in the compile screen. You'll see there are two specific project formats, one for professional and one for student. You shouldn't need to assign any layouts for these, they will all be set, as will the included documents in the list on the right. But do a quick check, just to make sure everything is as it should be, especially if your organisation uses an adapted APA format. The thing you do need to do is to fill out your metadata so that the front page works correctly. You also need to fill in the abbreviated title, because that's used in the header. There are various other options in the template's About section regarding things you might need to change, such as global font change and choosing different section layouts for a different effect. I'm not going to go through any of these because they will be very specific to your organisation's requirements. Just know that you might have to do these things, and they are detailed there. The compile for is automatically set to print, and the guidelines suggest using that, rich text or PDF, so I'm changing that to Word. And here are the results. They're just what the samples indicated, apart from the formatting of the footnotes. It's possible that has changed since the sample pages were originally formatted. You'll have to look that up. And I'll put my usual note here. If you do put this into Word for submission, and it has to be edited by someone else, remember this is not created using Word styles. You may want to go through it and implement those. So that's the basics of the APA paper. I'll probably do the MLA paper next, because that looks like it has a similar setup. Thanks for watching, and if you've subscribed, I'll see you again next time.